First of all, thank you very much for your invitation to take part to this meeting. According to I think what you are expecting from me is mainly to know what's the status of Belgian legislation in the case of universal jurisdiction. And I quite agree with what has just been said by Professor Ambos concerning the importance of evidence. Well, in Belgium, as you probably know, in 1993, we adopted a very ambitious law which allows Belgium to prosecute authors of international crimes, of international law crimes. And that law was that Belgium became the, I don't know what's the English expression, in French we say la terre promise, the land for all people in the world who get sufferings from dictatorial regimes. And unfortunately, as you know, there was the Yerodia case in 2002, where the ICJ considered that Belgium went too far, not concerning universal jurisdiction. In this framework, in fact, in the very beginning, the DRC argued that the exercise of universal jurisdiction was a violation of its sovereignty. But finally, during the oral pleadings, the DRC stopped contending this kind of argument. And finally, the whole case remained focused on the problem of immunity from criminal jurisdiction. And there, unfortunately, Belgium lost. That was my most important professional failure in my career, unfortunately. We did not succeed in convincing the court that, in fact, immunity from criminal jurisdiction was not an argument, was not an objection, was not a valid objection to the jurisdiction of domestic court, like the Belgian court. And but the case of universal jurisdiction was not dealt with by the court. The court didn't say anything about that. On the opposite, in 2012, in the Hissène Habré case, it was a real case of universal jurisdiction, and then we won the case, we fully won the case, and the court considered that, according to what Belgium said, Senegal was obliged either to prosecute Hissène Habré for the crimes which were attributed to him when he was the ruler of Chad. And if Senegal did not prosecute him, so he had to be extradited where a state which would like to prosecute him. And in fact, that was the case of Belgium. And as you know, finally, Senegal did not extradite Hissène Habré, but Hissène Habré was prosecuted in Senegal through an international criminal court, which was an ad hoc criminal court, which was set up by the African Union with the cooperation of Senegal, and also from a financial point of view, it was financed mainly by the European Union, by the United States, also by some states like Belgium or the Netherlands, who brought money in order to organize this trial. Well, the law was changed in 2002 after the judgment which was given by the court in the Yerodia case, DRC versus Belgium. the law was changed. And in fact, today, it is always possible to use universal jurisdiction, but it is submitted to the agreement of the federal prosecutor. The federal prosecutor has the right to see if there is a real possibility to prosecute the presumed perpetrator of an international law crime abroad, if there is no better possibility to prosecute this person, for instance, before an international criminal tribunal or international criminal court like the ICC, for instance, and if the case is not ill-founded. That's the reason why Professor Abbas is, of course, fully right to say that what is the most important thing is evidence. It's really very substantial to have evidence against the accused. And if these conditions are fulfilled, no problem, the person can be prosecuted. Should the indicted be present in Belgium, it's not explicitly said in the law. In fact, the law only says that that Belgium has jurisdiction and universal jurisdiction in cases where international law obliges states to exercise jurisdiction. And in fact, when you look at the instruments which criminalize international crimes, crimes against humanity through international custom mainly, or torture through the 1984 conventions, or like about 20 other international conventions, you see that in fact, the obligation to prosecute is always the application of the Latin maxim, aut dedere, aut judicare. It means either you extradite or you prosecute, you judge. And there is, in some conventions, it's not aut dedere, aut judicare, but it's more what I could say in Latin, judicare vel dedere, like in IHL, in the Geneva Conventions, it is not said that authors, perpetrators of IHL crimes must be the object of a request for extradition in order to get the obligation to prosecute. In fact, each state, each belligerent state is obliged to investigate concerning any IHL crimes, even if there is no request for extradition concerning the person. But in fact, when you look at the wording of the common article, the number changes in each of the four Geneva conventions. In fact, it's always when you read carefully the wording of the rules. I'm thinking of Article 130 of the third Geneva Convention, 147 of the fourth Geneva Convention. It's always when the presumed, the alleged perpetrator is found on the Belgian, on the territory of the prosecuting state. So you see that there are in Belgium some kind of limitation through this reference, the way we can prosecute, but in fact, it did not prevent Belgium to exercise universal jurisdiction, namely in the case of Rwanda during the 90s and the 2000 years were different people who were indicted with genocide or with crimes against humanity, and mainly with war crimes committed during the situation in Rwanda in 1994. These persons were indicted and condemned at the end before Belgian courts. So that's the situation actually in Belgium. And of course, yes, when I forgot to tell you that one of the reasons which could prevent the federal prosecutor to allow, to authorize an investigation would be the fact that the accused is protected by immunity from criminal jurisdiction. That's, of course, that was the lesson, that was one of the main effects of the Yerodia case, where unfortunately, which was a very bad judgment, of course, I'm not preventing myself to say that it was a very bad judgment because the court did not answer anything to Belgian arguments, mainly the arguments which were drawn from the works of the International Law Commission or from the Nuremberg judgment, for instance, where it was very clear that, in fact, either procedural issue, procedural objection based on immunity or substantive objection founded on the function of the accused were not objections, were not valid objections to the jurisdiction of the Nuremberg Tribunal. But the court did not answer anything to this argument or to the arguments which were drawn from the working of the International Law Commission. I'm thinking of the project of the draft code on crimes against mankind of 1996, and the court did not answer anything about that. That's the reason why I always consider that it's a very bad judgment. But that was the judgment, and so we have, of course, to comply with it. And so if the alleged perpetrator of an international law crime is found in Belgium, but if he is he is in function, if he's an incumbent member of the government, of his government, for instance, or her government, for instance, that's a real obstacle to the proceedings. So that's the status of the Belgian legislation for the present, of today. Thank you.